I am honored to introduce Vanessa German this evening. Tonight's lecture marks the end of a five-day visit with Vanessa. She has been present in Northwest Arkansas for a series of street performances and youth workshops. In fact, the lecture this evening will begin with a very special performance by Vanessa and the Bentonville High School Choir. They will perform an original work they created together during her visit here this week. I want to extend my thanks to these young artists who are joining us tonight. The program this evening will also conclude with a book signing here in the Great Hall, literally like right over there. Vanessa German is a visual and performance artist based in the Pittsburgh neighborhood of Homewood. As a citizen artist, German explores the power of art and love as a transformative force in the dynamic cultural ecosystem of communities and neighborhoods. She is the founder of Love Front Porch and the ARThouse, a community arts initiative for the children of Homewood. German is the recipient of numerous awards and grants, including the 2017 Jacob Lawrence Award from the American Academy of Arts and Letters, a 2018 United States Artist Grant, and the 2018 Don Tyson Prize. Now, I would like to welcome Olivia Tyson, granddaughter of Don Tyson, to extend a special welcome to Vanessa on behalf of the Don Tyson Prize.
Hi, good evening. When my family was considering a way to honor my grandfather, Don Tyson, we felt a prize in his name at Crystal Bridges would be fitting for this man, who was an art lover, a successful entrepreneur, a champion of education, and the personification of the American spirit. So, the Don Tyson Prize in Advancing American Art was created. Every other year, the prize recognizes individuals or organizations who have changed the way we look at, think about, or experience art, impacting the field through innovation, outside-the-box thinking, and risk-taking. In doing so, they've raised awareness, challenged preconceived notions, removed barriers, and ultimately increased accessibility. There's no question that the 2018 Don Tyson Prize awardee, Vanessa German, checks all those boxes. When my family and I visited Vanessa at her art house in Pittsburgh to present the prize this past December, we were all so deeply moved. We not only saw firsthand how Vanessa pushes boundaries and takes risks in her art, but how she is positively impacting her community through meaningful art experiences for the children. That and so much love. My grandfather would have been so pleased that Vanessa was chosen, and I know that I am too. So please welcome Vanessa German, the 2018 recipient of the Don Tyson Prize.
Yeah. Greetings, greetings, greetings. We're all here together. There really is no other place for us to be except all here together. Anybody tells you otherwise, they're lying to you. So we're going to begin with a performance created by myself in soulful, artistic collaboration with members of the Bentonville High School Choir. That sounds sweet, doesn't it? It's something in there that just sounds nice. So, it's a choir. Y'all worked together. It's not sweet. So it's hard. It's difficult. And what comes next isn't necessarily going to be a simple, sweet thing with which to digest and to bear witness to. With that said, if there is anyone in here who has loud noise PTSD, is triggered by gunshots or by scenes of violence, I'm giving you this opportunity, if you're here with a small child, to remove yourself from the space. And I'm doing this because I don't think that it's fair to surprise people and to stun people with, as stunning as it is in the world that we live in, I'm warning you. And I don't think that it would be fair to surprise you. So I'm warning you that you could take a moment outside if loud noises or scenes of violence are especially triggering to you. And I want you to know that I talk in front of people a lot. I actually do the same talk all the time. What I'm doing tonight, I have never done before. So I ask you for a space of grace in this newness and in the vulnerability and in the heart that it will take for myself and the students to be here. I often wonder, as an artist who is in love with artists and in love with art spaces and in love with Black people, I often wonder what it takes for the artists that I love to be who they are and to make their work. Because I see them give lectures, I visit their studios sometimes, and I wonder where their places of dimensional struggle and triumph are. I wonder how they make it through their practice, through their touring schedule, through just being a whole entire human being. So what I'm going to do with you today is to show you my behind the scenes. I'm going to share with you the layers of my process and what it takes for me to be who I am, to make the work that I make, and to stay alive. This is what it takes for me, and what you'll experience through story, through images, through our performance, are some of the ingredients of this lived experience. People often introduce me with great soft joy because they know that I'm loving, but I don't know if they know what it takes. So if you need to step out, step out. We're going to begin the performance, and I ask you to support these young artists with your being, to offer them a space of grace, and to recognize the newness and the courage that they're bringing into the space today. Thanks.
Why are they shooting at him? No, I'm recording this. Why are they shooting? All they did was run, and they're shooting at them. Why are they shooting at him? No, I'm recording this. Why are they shooting? All they did was run, and they're shooting at them. Why are they shooting at him? No, I'm recording this. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting? All they did was run. Why are they shooting?
Thank you. Into processing this particular crime, the crimes that occurred in North Braddock, a call comes in and says shots are fired in East Pittsburgh. When detectives arrive, the scene is secure. The victim, Antoine Rose, had already been transported to McKeesport Hospital. By all accounts, Mr. Rose never did anything in furtherance of any crimes in North Braddock. I know there's been some speculation in the media. In East Pittsburgh, there are three spent casings that are recovered. They'll go back to a 9 millimeter weapon. That's the weapon of Michael Rosfeld. There are two witnesses that are proximate to the location of the shooting. There is a video. From talking to the family this morning, we like to get the phone. We don't have the phone right now. We have the YouTube version of that video. It's significant because we want to enhance it a little bit more. The driver is extracted from the vehicle. He's on the ground. As the officer begins to put cuffs on him, the two passengers get out of the car. According to the witnesses, Rose shows his hands, turns, and runs. He is not in possession of a weapon. Neither is the other passenger in the dark T-shirt. The medical examiner did the autopsy and submitted various reports. Antoine Rose was hit three times. He was hit in the side of the face, in the cheek. The bullet exits through the nasal cavity. He's also hit in the right elbow from the rear. That's a through and through wound. He's hit in the mid-back, and that slug was recovered in his chest. That's the fatal shot. As I said before, that 9 millimeter slug matches Rosfeld's service weapon. The at-scene Facebook posting is consistent with the independent witnesses' statements. And as I said before, there's no weapon that would have created a risk to Officer Rosfeld. Based on that evidence, I find that Rosfeld's actions were intentional, and they certainly brought about the result that he was looking to accomplish. He was not acting to prevent death or serious bodily injury. It's my position that he is not entitled to a justification charge to a jury as a defense, inasmuch as under Pennsylvania law, if you are effectuating an arrest, you have to show the person to be arrested has committed a forcible felony. As I said already, Antoine Rose didn't do anything in North Braddock other than be in that vehicle. And you have to possess a weapon. Neither of those young men were in possession of a weapon. Where you have to otherwise indicate that somebody is in a position to take human life, and that is not the case here.
Do you believe Antoine Rose fired a gun at all that night?
No, he did not. The charges against the officer?
Yes.
One count of criminal homicide. The evidence supports third-degree murder. There's no doubt about that in my mind. Manslaughter, voluntary manslaughter, involuntary manslaughter. But we think we should have the right to argue murder in the first degree. For first-degree murder, that's life. Third degree is 20 to 40 years. Manslaughter is 3.5 to 7. It's an intentional act, and it's done recklessly. And there is no justification for it.
DA, what's your message to Antoine's family?
We had a very nice conversation. They're very decent people. Obviously, they're very distraught about the loss of their son, who by all indications is a good kid. I'm going to keep that private between us, but it was a good conversation.
And for the community?
You can't take somebody's life under these circumstances. Taking human life is the most important. It's one of the most important things in this community, dealing with those types of tragedies. You do not shoot somebody in the back if they are not a threat to you.
Now calling a case of police brutality. Video showing police using mace on at least one of two teenagers. Local 10 News reporter Kristen De La Rosa live now with a controversial video for us tonight. Kristen.
Calvin, there are still bloodstains on the street here. That's how violent things got as dozens of young people were watching and recording. A Broward County deputy pepper sprays a teen. Another deputy seen swinging a punch, banging the teen's head on the street. Bloodstains can be seen on the ground. Multiple witnesses recording on their cell phones.
Yo, what? Yo, why you niggas are bugging?
What the fuck?
I am confused and afraid. I wonder what path I will take. I hear that there's only two ways out. I see mothers bury their sons. I want my mom to never feel that pain. I am confused and afraid. I pretend all is fine. I feel like I'm suffocating. I touch nothing, so I believe all is fine. I worry that it isn't, though. I cry no more. I am confused and afraid. I understand people believe I'm just a statistic. I'm different. I dream of life getting easier. I try my best to make my dream true. I hope that it does. I am confused and afraid.
That I knew. She drew and grew a slew of ruthless and wild-winged weapons from the swell of her hips. She raised us up and she aimed our faces to the stars. She said, see, there you are, shining back at yourself. From a billion brilliant light years away, isn't that amazing? You came all of this way to stand in the light of your own shine. So do not believe them when they tell you that the very best that you can do and be with your life is cute. Don't believe them when they tell you that the very best that you can do and be with your life is prettier than the rest of the girls, or desperate enough to die trying for it, because those are lies. The truth is, there is an entire universe of ideas alive inside of you right now, and they are spinning on the axis of your breath. So rise up and let them out. My mother said, this is all I could tell you. This is how you live your life, right? Be creative and be brave. That way you always gonna have the guts and the good ideas with which to make changes. Be creative and be brave. I live in Pittsburgh. That's my house. So from my house to your house, like, what do you see in that picture? You could just say it out loud, just like say something. What do you see? What'd you say? Oh, and why would I have a Puerto Rican flag? Because from what I heard on Twitter, Puerto Rico isn't even, like, what does Puerto Rico have to do with America? Like, why would I have that flag? Why would I have a Puerto Rican flag hanging in front of my house? With what? Because Puerto Rican people, from what I heard on Twitter, they're not even people. Right? But I am? Well, actually, they are too, right? They are too. So I got a Puerto Rican flag in my front yard. I have a bottle tree. I have a whole bunch of flowers. I have a yard sign from the artist Alicia Wormsley's project, There Are Black People in the Future. Which, if you know the story, was too controversial to be up in Pittsburgh. People were so offended. They were like, oh my God. Black people in the future, but we don't really even want them here now. And so, of course, the company protested and they made them take this obvious, to me, this is just like a statement of fact. Your heart is beating. There are black people in the future. So, when I think about what it takes to be an artist in Pittsburgh and what it takes to love, creative, understanding, redemptive, transformative, goodwill, to be loving, intentionally, deliberately, all the verbs together. What does it take to be black and fat and queer and loving and make art in a world, in a city, where the district attorney could get on television and say, this is there within the laws of Pennsylvania, there's no reason why this police officer had the right, was within policy or the law to shoot and kill this child. That happened 6 miles away from my house. And as you saw, that police officer was acquitted. So you heard the DA say, there's no reason. This child did nothing. He did nothing except be in a jitney. Criminal homicide. That's what the DA said. And of course, the officer who killed Antoine, who I last saw at Woodland Hills High School the day that me and a group of my friends showed up there at 5:45 in the morning with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of flowers to just stand out in front of the school and give flowers to kids as they got off the bus. Because they had lost so many students. At the school, they had so many students, like one student was killed every month in the first 3 months of the school year, which is devastating. It's inhuman to ask children to contend with that much grief without wrapping such an immense amount of care around them. So we just show up in the morning with literally 800, 1,000 flowers and just start handing them out. He was the last kid I saw walk in the school. And I know he was the last kid, and we'll never forget this because he was the last kid, so we all did a slow clap for him. We were like, you're tardy. And the next day I know I get a phone call. Cops have shot this kid. I'm in my studio. I'm supposed to be making art. But I'm a citizen artist. So what do I do with my body? At this time, do I leave my studio where I'm actually creating with a group of women, a group of women who come to the ArthouseTo do something called the Tuesday Night Monologue Project, And so I have to decide, do I say that happens, the police kill kids? You know, like, I'm busy. Or do I put my body in a car and do I go to this space? Well, as you see, I put my body in the car and we all went to the space. So I'm always thinking about, as a citizen artist, what do I do with my body? How can I use my voice? Do I get to love myself? How much sacrifice is too much sacrifice? How much grief is too much grief? My friends are always telling me, Vanessa, you have to move out of this neighborhood. It's too much. You can afford to move, Vanessa, move. But can I afford to move? Can the children afford for me to move? So we're looking at love. We are looking at love, and we're looking at what it takes to make this work. So I am going to show you images, share stories, and be as honest as I can with myself and with you. So everything that you have seen up to now, Lauren getting on stage, Olivia getting on stage, invoking the name of her grandfather, Lauren, who is a rare human being. Rare. Doing work that is making the future. Me getting up here, the students from Bentonville, the students' teachers, Holly, Alice, everybody here, everything that you have seen happen, everything, all of this is love. All of this is loving. Do not confuse yourself. Loving looks like Lauren making the future. Loving is Olivia saying, we made this decision. This is a living loving. This is Zoe standing outside of the old art house with this sign I've made that says love on purpose. These are some of my ancestors, some of my the women ancestors in my line. Look at them. They got light skin. They got long hair. That's Louisiana. They're black and native. Take a moment to think about your ancestors. Take a moment to think about your ancestors. Take a moment to think about the people who are inside of you, who are not physically present right now. My ancestors come to me in dreams, and they're always like a little perturbed. It's like they're like my probation officers or something. And they come to me in dreams, and they just sit in the sky. And then they wait for me to appear before them, like, you know, like you gotta appear at court. And then in the dreams, I'm always like, and then I go and I stand in the sky with my ancestors, and only one of them speaks. And they point at me and they talk to me like they're impatient. They're like, why don't you get this yet? And they tell me, they say one word and they say, create. Create. So as a citizen artist, as an artist, as a whole human being, as a dope, queer, fat, black femme alive on this planet right now, going through nights where I leave creating to go put my body on a street corner, I must always be in a state where I am dipping my spirit into the truth that my ancestors have been coming to me since I was a child, telling me one word, create, create. So as a self-taught artist, as someone who did not come through the academy, I'm always in this space where I'm balancing out. Can I work from my soul? Can I make because I love? One curator said, you shouldn't tell people that how much you love art. He said, people will think you're hyper-spiritual. And I was like, well, then what does that make you? Like, what's the opposite of hyper-spiritual? Because I want to avoid whatever you're doing right now. That's not success to me. You're frightening. Can I make from love? Can I tell people, will people take me seriously if I stand up in front of an audience at my favorite museum and say, my ancestors come to me in dreams? And think of what it costs to be creative and brave. This is a work of art that I did called Power Figure to Keep Me Alive. I have seriously attempted suicide 3 times in my life. And the last time I said, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna do this experiment, this thing that Lauryn Hill did. She talks about where on Lauryn Hill's Unplugged album, she says, I was going the wrong direction in my life. And there's no rule, there's no law of physics that says you can't turn things around. So I, at the time, was seeing a lot of bumper stickers that said, there's power in art, there's power in love. And I'm like, y'all hippies need to quit, because it's hard out here. And I just decided, I said, you know what, I'm gonna do a scientific experiment and I will keep myself alive for 6 months. If at the end of this 6 months, making things doesn't keep me alive, then life isn't worth living. I lived in this, I was squatting in a row house in Homewood. To find out more about my neighborhood, you can Google Homewood. You can look up a two-part series that Rachel Maddow did called Homewood, America's Most Violent Neighborhood, which is a lie, right? And I only have 30 minutes. I almost read into that right there. Y'all saw me just like be like, okay. So I was in despair. It was unbearable for me trying to figure out how to stay alive and be whole and inhabit my entire humanity with as much truth and guts as I could. And so I was gonna kill myself. Instead, I would walk around my neighborhood with my little dog, and I would have a poop bag, and I would have another bag, and I would pick up stuff off the ground. I'd go to my moldy basement, and I would stack wood up until it felt right. 6 months passed, I made several figures like this, and I realized when I was making the figures that something was happening to me. Something was happening to my body. And those of you in here who are artists, who are writers, you have felt that thing happen to you. It is the technology of your soul. It is human technology. It's what happens to artists when you are imagining. It's what happens to your nervous system. It's what happens to your brain when you are engineering, imagining. Your physical body is active at the same time and you're working intentionally. It's that place of flow. That happened to me, and I called that space of creating, of contending with my sorrow, my body, my despair, in the static free frequency of making. I found the love of my life. I found this loving, and I decided after this point that I would spend the rest of my life, it wouldn't be a bad life if I just spent the rest of my life making things, inviting people to make things with me, and sharing what I love. I figure, think about this, all of the people in this room, think about something that you love. Do you love golfing? Do you love pancakes? Do you love chocolate? Do you love basketball? Think about intentionally, deliberately sharing what you love and telling people that that's what you're doing once a month. Think about giving yourself a love day. Set up a little flapjack stand in your front house and make pancakes for people. No, seriously, see what happens when you start intentionally speaking that you are sharing love on purpose, because that's what I started to do. So let's look at some of the ways that I am inhabiting my life as a citizen artist. And I think about the word citizen as a citizen of the earth, an earthling. I'm an earthling. How can I be the most earthling that I can be? How can I be the most queerest I can be? Joy, oh joy. Everybody said joy to the world. All right. So citizen artists, so let's look at what some of the ingredients of this life are. Oh, everybody said joy to the world. That's me, y'all, on the front porch in Homewood with Miss Debbie getting my hair corn rolled. I found that the best artist talks happen on the street. So I would take sculptures out the house. I walk with them down the street. People be like, yo. And then everybody, what is that? That voodoo? They say, you made that. You made that in Homewood? And then, especially dudes who just got out of prison, they'd be like, I make stuff too. I'd be like, oh really, what you make? You know how many graphic novels I've seen come out of prison? For real, and these men, they don't know that this is a real thing. Maybe they've done a bid for so long, they were never introduced to graphic novels. Guys come up to me showing me books filled with the most beautiful things, and I have to say, you know that's real, right? You know that's real. this is something called a graphic novel. Nah, nah, man, this is just what I did to stay cool, to stay even in prison. I'm like, it's real. That's yours. That's medicine that can make you some money. Publish that, get that published. So walking around the neighborhood is the museum, is the gallery, is the exhibition space, is the space where I gather material, invisible material and physical material. So sitting on the front porch getting my hair braided, this is how I stay alive. I stay alive by making things. I need to make something every day. Sarah Siegerlin, when did I get this fabric?
Saturday.
Because wasn't I up in the 21C with a hot glue gun? Five things of paint, some tool, and the people at 21C are like, what's she doing? Today I came out like, I feel like busting loose. I feel like busting loose. And they just hear me playing Lizzo. So I'm making all the time. It's an integral ingredient into my survival, into the way that I inhabit my body and my being. So I'm out in the street with this work that I made with Miss Debbie, who's Zoe's mom, the kid holding up the love sign. She's dead. We're at the art house one day, right? Zoe's standing on the sidewalk and she's not moving, which is weird. She's standing in one place. And I look at her and say, Zoe, what's up? And she just starts crying. She starts crying. The art house is open, kids are in the art house. Everybody wants pizza. I'm like, come on, like come into the house, we gotta do this. And I say, what's wrong? And she said, Twist told me that my mom is dying. They took her to the hospital. I said, Zoe, I just saw your mom. I saw your mom this morning. And she said, I did too, but they took her to the hospital. She's not home. And I said, who took her to, what's going on? So I shut the art house down early, and I take Zoe to the house, knock on the door, a drug dealer answers the door. And I was like, where's Zoe's mom? Ambulance took her to the hospital. What hospital? West Penn. I put the kid in the car, we go to the hospital. Because she's flipping out. The last time she saw her mom did her hair for her to go to school. Miss Debbie, who's doing my hair, right there on the front porch in Homewood with me wearing a 60s-inspired muumuu standing next to a sculpture that I made to save my own life. So we go to the hospital. It's the last time Zoe sees her mom. She's dying. Whatever they cooked the drug with went to her brain. And that's the last time Zoe saw her mom. I was with her at the hospital. So we started out with this joy, right? Look at my face. What does it take to make it past this place? What does it take to keep making? I love Zoe. Some of y'all met Zoe. I've known her for years. And I have to negotiate this place constantly. I'm constantly negotiating the place of trauma. I'm constantly negotiating this place of violence. I'm constantly negotiating my physical presence in a place where I found five bodies. That's what it takes. It's this constant negotiation. And that some Black people come to me and they're like, why do you talk about the trauma? Why do you talk about the pain? It's so triggering. Black joy, yo. Self-care, yo. And I'm like, maybe this is it. Maybe this is the self-care. So in this place of despair, this place of experiencing so much death, so much Black death on video, like the videos we saw, I started to notice a few years ago, the summer that Mike Brown was killed in Ferguson, that my friends on social media were saying things I'd never seen them say before. They were saying things like, I don't even want to go outside. I want to call off work Black today. I don't want to do anything at all anymore, or I'm just not okay. So what I started to do was invite my friends over to my house. I would say, look, I'm shooting this photo series. I just invented it. I pulled it out of the air. I said, I'm shooting a photo series. Why don't you come to my house and I will make you some clothes and you can tell me how you want to feel and we'll shoot these beautiful photos. And so people would come to my house. I would clean the house. I would put incense. I would put incense on and I would make the space as lovely and beautiful as I could. I would say, what kind of music should we listen to? And I would create this space, a space that was as sacred as I could make it. And I would sit the person in front of me, and I will have asked them on the phone, I will have said, how do you want to feel in these photographs? What is a way that you want to feel? And people would say, I want to feel like Beyonce. And I'm like, are you sure? Or they would say, I want to feel, one girl said, I want to feel like a riot. And I was like, I get that. I feel that. So I would come and sit a person in front of me. I would sit them in front of me, and I would be so gentle with them. And I would be so tender with them. Somebody come up here. Anyone. Thank you. I see you. You walk nice. You walk nice. I see. Oh, you got a name tag on it. Make it easy. So I would bring someone to the house. I put them in the clothes that I made for them. And I would touch them. And I'd look them in their eyes, and I would put makeup on them, and sometimes I would paint their bodies, and I would sing while I was doing it to have intentional moments of tenderness and creativity. And as an artist and as a human being who has decided to intentionally and deliberately and creatively and with belief in the spirit of transformation, love the best that I can, I would make an ecosystem of creative understanding, redemptive goodwill, and I would make a spectacle of it. And sometimes I do that with people like I did in Bentonville, where I just sat at the farmer's market and I made poems for people. And they would sit in front of me on rose petals and I would say, give me some ingredients. Because all I want to do is be here with you. I want to be here with you. I want to be seen by you. And I want to be safe while I'm doing it, right? So I say, like, I need three things. I need a name, a color, and a purpose. And I'm going to make a poem for you. So give me a name.
Darren.
Green.
Living.
So, Jason. Is there anything else you want to tell me about the name that you just chose?
Darren is the name of my nephew. He just recently passed. My family found the police called my family, told them they found his body washed up on somebody's backyard. My nephew was 26. I am the youngest of 8 sisters. I love my family, and it's kind of getting hard to move on.
It's getting hard to move on. It is, isn't it? So I'm gonna make a poem. This is a love poem for your soul, which is connected always to the soul of every single person that you've ever loved and every single person that they ever loved and ever loved before them. This is a love poem for the way that your nephew lives inside of your bones, his smile rising through the marrow of your bones. Right this very instant, arms become wings and they swing out in the green of spring. Right behind you, become consumed with this truth. Let it bloom, let it rise, neon, let it tip, tap, and tap dance like Gregory Hines.
spinning behind your heartbeat. Sometimes I feel like I just can't go on. And then I have to get up and work in the morning. I gotta put on clean clothes and clean pants and put this little name tag on my chest and make it seem like everything is okay when all I wanna do is lay down and put my tears into the earth and say, bring him back. Put him back. Unwind his body from the shore. Time go back, time go back. And it's a fact that all time exists in one plane. We are in the simultaneity of time this very instant. It is all here. It is all here. And it is all right now. And I wish I could tell you how to make it hurt less, but I cannot. All I can say is that the love is here and it is inside of you and it blooms anew with every breath you take. If you look over your shoulder, you'll see it shining in the noonday sun and you will begin to feel Darren's mother's sun in every single thing around you. And sometimes it will be enough. Most of the time it won't. And you'll move through the world. And your feet will rock. And your hair will grow. And your eyes will blink. And you will fall deeply, deeply in love. And you will raise the sun up from the sound of your voice. And you will move and you will make. And your feet, they will shake, and your heart, it will beat. And everyone in this room will keep the name of your nephew alive and alive and alive in the inside of the inside of the inside. In the inside of the inside of the inside. For the here and for the now and for the truth and for the wow of it all. I tell you that I love you. And I'm learning how to do it better and better every single day. If I could build a bridge from my heart to yours, I would come rescue you when sometimes the grief is too much. And maybe we could rescue each other when the grief is too much for me. I thank you for this sea and for this way between us. I thank you for your truth. And for that fly walk that you hit coming up to this stage. I thank you for the way that you are making the future, where no more Darrens will wash ashore anybody's backyard ever again. We have to protect our hope. And so I protect the hope by protecting you. Thank you. All right, so I'm gonna go through the rest of these pretty quickly because time is doing what time does. So I shoot this series, this little boy stopped and when I was shooting, this is an activist, one of the Black Lives Matter activists in Pittsburgh. She has a binder full of death threats. She's out there in the alleyway, so I would move somebody from this place of tenderness and creativity and intentional loving and intentional proximity, deep tenderness, and we would parade around the streets of Homewood. And what would happen is people would stop us. Kids would stop us, and they would be like, this little boy stopped, and he said to his friend on these like little dangerous motorbikes, he's like, is there somebody standing in the field? And his friend's like, yeah, it's the lady standing over there in the field. And the boy said, oh, I thought I saw an angel. And I said, nah, that's Julia. You should get in that picture with her. And he did.
And so what I do with the photo series is it becomes a ritual, it becomes a procession, it becomes a performance, and we move it out through the neighborhood. I look at social media, and that's how I find the subjects for the photo series. I look at them, and I say, how do you want to feel? And then we come to the house, because I believe so thoroughly in the power of love and so thoroughly in the power of art that I do not have the privilege to not ask it to do everything that I need it to do. I don't have the privilege to not ask the art, the museum, the work, the process to do absolutely everything that I need it to do. So out in the street, parading around, that's Zoe. We're in the hidden graffiti field. This is my friend Ramona, 6 months after her daughter was killed. I see her on social media say, I've been lying. I've been acting like I'm okay, like I can move on, like I understand grief, and I don't. And the next day she was at my house, and we were making these photos because people know that I'm an artist in the community. People come to me. They look for this place, and now it's become a thing where people reach out to me, because one of the things that is missing in our communities, in my community specifically, one is the public memory that holds the space for the entirety of the lives who were lost on our street. There's no space for us to grieve and to love and to hold the wholeness of ourselves within our own community. And I'm gonna show you one of the ways that we created a space to grieve, because what was happening in the media is what happened to Antoine. The reason why the DA in that video said, I'm letting you know this kid didn't do anything. He didn't have a gun. He furthered no crimes. And the reason he said that is because people in the comments section and the newspapers and the televisions were saying he had a gun. He shot all these people. He did this. And the news stations would not remove that content. They wouldn't remove it. And so what happens then is this kid who taught gymnastics. He worked at a skateboard shop. He was a snowboarder and a poet. This kid never got to be whole. He just kept getting murdered over and over and over and over again in the media. So his family didn't have a chance to say he was so beautiful, he was so fly. Girls loved him. They flocked to be by his side. So finding places where we get to tell our own whole story, right? So moving through the community, seeing a whole bunch of stuff on media about how dark-skinned black girls don't get married. Dark-skinned black girls don't get this. Dark-skinned black girls don't do anything. And I say, dark-skinned black girls do whatever they want to do. Quit with your headlines. This is the writer, Tamika Cage Conley, in the alleyway in Homewood. This is the artist, Black Rap Medusa, who was hemmed up by the police, arrested, put in jail for saving two young black girls, like 12 or 13 at the movie theater, from getting dragged by the police, physically dragged. And she intervened, so they arrested her and said, this is the way artists have to put their bodies on the line. But we consider the risk of this, thinking about Erica Garner, thinking about Eric Garner's daughter who's dead now. Like she said, the fight takes so much. The fight takes so much. Thinking about all those activists in Ferguson who are dead now, all those artists and activists. So how do we keep it together? How do we hold it together? This is kids at the art house. Sometimes I just have to get down in their faces sometimes and tell them really forcefully how beautiful they are. And we take these pictures, mothers and daughters. That's my assistant, student at Yale. Her name's Ada. Parading a spectacle of beauty, a spectacle of tenderness, a spectacle of love, because we're learning how to love each other, not just love iPhones and new jeans and your lip gloss. We are learning how to be in loving with each other, which is what you saw us do with the Bentonville High School Choir. We formed a creative community. We were there for each other. We bore witness. You know, I never see white youth bearing witness to black youth being beaten and dragged and killed by the police. I always see black people looking at that. So it was interesting working with those students. I said, does this happen in your community? And they said, no. Only one girl said, I don't know. And I was like, I appreciate your honesty. So this is my assistant, Ada. This is parading out in the street. I think about how Titus Kaffir says, proximity breeds possibility. So we're out in the street with the blacks. The kids see us because they got like a GPS signal on me. They're like, beep, beep, Miss Vanessa's outside. And so they see it, they run up to us and they're looking at Ada. They're like, ooh, she light skin, is she black? And I'm like, she black. So we cover that. Because I was surprised how early children function through colorism. That's actually been surprising to me. I thought that we fixed it, but we didn't. And so they're looking at her, they're like, ooh, what does she do? And I'm like, she's an art history student at Yale. They're like, what's Yale? And I'm like, it's a university. They're like, ooh, could I go to Yale? And I'm like, you could do whatever you want to do. And then with the Yale thing, I'd be like, so that's a choice, though. You're going to have to... You're gonna have to massage that one through because I know a whole bunch of black people who had nervous breakdowns at Yale. So this is this is in the neighborhood. This is the writer Brian Broom, artist. And I'm gonna read you this poem. Remember the day, this is a true story. Remember the day that we were walking around taking pictures and you were wearing that suit that I painted for you and those golden spray-painted boxing gloves that gleamed in the alleyway just outside of the art house and the garden and how we were joyful experimenters in the art of being black artists, leaders, winged creatures from the heights of our own imaginations and enjoying one another's company and getting to know one another's company when the police came up on us, a car full of them, both blue and pale at the same time, and how still we got standing there, how we didn't move too much, how our bodies became each other's bodies, and not even our arms swaying the way they did before we were stopped there in our own place for being black and American and amazing all at the same time. The truth is, I'd have stopped us too because we were fly. Me, with all of those cameras around my neck, and you in the glow out, in the supreme shine, in the utter hallelujah of the moment, and how that one officer rolled down his window and did something that he could do because he knew he could do it, and anything that we did to not do what he was making us do would have been deemed probable cause. And so we stood there and we made our breath as tiny as the buttons on his lapel. We made ourselves a shelter for our own imaginations and hid that shelter in a secret place in the small of our backs. And then finally, when the police drove off and we had our own eyes back to our own selves, we did a check-in. And you said you was cool, and I said I was cool, but really, I wanted to cry. I wanted to lay down and put my tears into the earth because I felt like we were violated in our own place. But you was like, nah, we good. So I said, nah, I'm good. And we went on. And then I took this photo of you with this beautiful little girl. And when I see this picture, I see how beautiful we are. And then I remember what we went through just to get to this place. And then this picture is made all the more holy. So walking around the neighborhood shooting the blacks, kids start to follow me. And they start just putting on, the adornments. Miss Vanessa, take a picture of me, I'm a king. That's what Ra-Ra is saying right there. I'm a king. Also then, in the work that I'm creating, making more space for dopeness, for queerness, because I'm thinking about the radical black imagination. I'm thinking about queering the future and how much possibility there is inside of that, protecting this space. This is work that I create for the National Ceramics Educators Conference. This is a trans man, first time out in public after surgery. His whole family came, and they were cheering for him and taking pictures. And all of these moments and spaces and creations I'm making to do this dimensional work. So inside of the museum here, you see these sculptures. They're in a museum. You see all this art here. But what that work is Zoe. That work is me working to protect Zoe's imagination. That piece of ceramic wearable art, that's a shield for this black trans man who 6 or 7 months later gets beat so bad outside of a 7-Eleven downtown Pittsburgh that you wouldn't even recognize him. Making space for us to be Black and American and amazing at the same time. Safe space for this. All of this is love. I'm gonna go fast through these. I'm gonna tell you about this really quick. This is me appropriating Serena Williams on the cover of Vogue magazine the year that she was going in for the Grand Slam. If you look at the comment section under any of those magazines, you see that people are saying, why would she be the greatest of all time? She's a monkey, she's a gorilla, she's not even a woman, we should test her testosterone, which gutted me. And so I began to turn all these covers of Vogue magazine into as with Serena Williams as the mother of all creation. This is me wanting to be in the Met. So I took all the Met maps and painted Black Madonnas on them and then stuffed them back in the information pockets. And I paint the Black Madonna all the time as a prayer. I paint the Black Madonna after things are hard in the street. I paint the Black Madonna when I was at the emergency room all the time and at the cancer center. I would paint the Black Madonna on everything. This is the Black Madonna of the fuck you. So one of the things I think about as a citizen artist is art and service. Like how can my work be of dimensional service, the best service possible? And this is before the Me Too movement. And one of the things I was hearing from like my friends around me was this sort of constipated space of not being able to speak to all the microaggressions and all the ways that there was these incremental rapes of their humanity. And I love how in Haitian voodoo, you can apply the image of the Black Madonna and the spirit of the Black Madonna to any cause you want. Like there's the Black Madonna that just protects gay men. There's the Black Madonna who protects women who've been beaten by their husbands. So I made the Black Madonna of the fuck you. So that if you were at work and your boss just kept slipping his hand a little bit too far down the small of your back, you could come into this museum. And lots of places wouldn't show this. When it first showed at a museum in New York, I started to know it was effective when it was showing up on social media and people were like, thank you, Vanessa German. I didn't know how much I needed to say fuck you to Bob. Bob, that's the last time you touched me like that in the copy room. I'm not kidding. So this was before the Me Too movement. And I was really surprised how many in the museum when this shows there's slips of paper and people would just be saying all these things that had been pent up inside of them. Because as a citizen artist, one of the things I'm most interested in is what can the power of art do? I'm interested in social healing. I'm interested in social connection. So I'm just gonna go through these. The work that you see here in the museum is like probably the last singular discrete objects that I made. I don't make just one sculpture anymore. I make entire communities of sculptures. This is called I Come to Do a Violence to the Lie. This is the alleyway behind the Hart House. It's Formosa Way. It's that famous Killing Fields place that you could hear about on the internet. Or this is the place where those row houses were, where people would cut holes in one side of the row house and hide bodies. And then the other side of the row house, they could run from the police without being on the street. They have demolished almost all of the Killing Fields. That's the alleyway behind the art house. So taking the work out of the studio onto the street, thinking about what the work can do, what the site of the work can do, intentionally putting soul and love and spirit and working intellectually and spiritually in my studio. My studio is both an intellectual space, a conceptual space, and a spiritual space. And those are balanced out, and they have to be because I'm a whole entire human being. Up the alleyway from right where you see Zoe there is where the police killed Mark Daniels. Asking for help in the neighborhood, the way that my neighbors become art handlers. So this is the work in the Matrix show at the Wadsworth Atheneum, and how proud my neighbors were to be like, I helped move that. I helped do this. This is work that I started to create spaces where when I began doing this immersive, large-scale figurative installations with soundtracks and special lighting and subwoofers and sculptures and walls, and in the walls, this is an army of 31 Black female power figures. This is a soundtrack that is probably 25 layers of sound that for me is the simultaneity of time. I'm going, thank you for your grace with this time. Sometimes We Cannot Be With Our Bodies is another immersive installation that I created. This is all new work. This work is in Charlottesville right now. And so I'm thinking about the neighborhood. I'm thinking about that way that I take the people I'm photographing out into the street, and it becomes a procession. It becomes a ritual, which is important when you're living with so much trauma around you. It's important to physically move your body, not to just sit and try to eat something that's really sugary, but to actually drink a glass of water and to move around. So bringing this space of ritual, this space of procession, this space of pilgrimage into institutions, sometimes we cannot be with our bodies, I force the viewer into this ritual. It says sometimes cannot be with our bodies. So you would walk through this space, stopping to read all the text on the wall, which is a mix of text from Toni Morrison's Song of Solomon and Yah Jesse's Homegoing. This is what it looked like when it was installed at the Mattress Factory in Pittsburgh. So the ritual begins outside. You progress into an antechamber, a trophy room. You're walking and you're moving. You're forced to do this by the design of the exhibition. You are forced into pilgrimage with other viewers, around into a space, over the earth, a trophy room, heads invoking those great alabaster sculptures through a red curtain, acknowledging the fact that sometimes being in museums, this is just an act of theater. Sometimes it's an intentional, deliberately crafted spectacle. But for me, it's always something more. It has to be more. I have to ask it for everything. In through a red curtain into an immersive, dizzying, kaleidoscopic space. Inside of this space, I created Sometimes We Cannot Be With Our Bodies because I was devastated, all the black trans women who were being murdered. I was devastated watching the video where Tamir Rice gets shot and killed less than 2 seconds after the police rolled up on him. So it's this spectacle of joy and celebration and triumph. These headless figures inside a space where inside of this ritual progression, I have inserted performers. And you might not know who they are. They're just the person next to you, and they could just start out bringing song, which is unexpected. People expect to have sort of like a close, intimate experience. And then all of a sudden, the person next to you is, feel we're close enough. And what she's doing is she's singing love songs. Singing love songs to the work for the love that they'll never get to have. Performing this work, I can perform any sculpture that I created. This is performing Sometimes We Cannot Be With Our Bodies. We'll go into the community, bring a group of willing people forward. I'll tell them what the ritual performance is. It's called the goodbye song. I bring all of the clothes, put clothes on people, and then we go in. You notice that only one person is standing with a cell phone. When we do these ritual performances through in the spaces, these immersive spaces that I create, I don't let people film it with their cell phone. The only people who can film with their cell phone are people of color, or black women. I don't let the museum let anybody experience the work behind a screen. You have to be present for it. And I will let people of color and black women, black trans women, of course, record if they need to. This is performance of Sometimes We Cannot Be With Our Body, Phenomenology of Black Girlhood, Work as Service, The Loving as Service. Thinking about all of the girls in my neighborhood, thinking about all of the secrets and the lies that are kept in their body, thinking about how much they're getting suspended from school and how nobody is thinking about their imaginations and pulling the scars off of their imaginations, thinking about all of the fat girls who cut their thighs, thinking about all of the fat girls who starved themselves, thinking about all of the fat girls who didn't get a chance to love their fat. I think about how one of the leading causes of death for children in this country is now suicide, children ages 10 to 13. Thinking about how we need more spaces for grief, to process through our grief, using the technology of our soul, having people to hold our hands, this entire body of work, because I'm not making singular discrete objects, Phenomenology of Black Girlhood, this is Nia Wilson, stabbed to death, Oakland, by a white supremacist. This is a work I made called Love Poem for Nia Wilson. And sometimes I just have to do it. I couldn't forget the sound of her sister screaming her name. And so one of the things that I have to do to make it, to even stand here in front of you, is make this. Miracles and Glory Abound is my MAGA. It's me riffing off of Lutz's Washington Crossing the Delaware. But of course, we're outside in Homewood. My Washington is called LaQuisha Washington. She's a single mother, she's holding a baby. And this isn't just like black washing history. For me, this is future making. This is the work in a museum, it's traveling around the country right now. So it's not just the boat, it's the water, it's the lookers, it's a fictional park. It's a little bit of Octavia Butler science fiction because there are three suns shining on this instead of the one sun that is in Lutz's Washington Crossing the Delaware, which is God telling Washington that it is right for you to do this. You can move forward. God says it is so. And so in my Washington Crossing the Delaware, LaQuisha Washington Crossing the Day Aware, she has got three sons telling her, yeah, it's for you. This future and this path is for you. So this is the figure in the museum, and this is little girls in front of the figure trying to be that figure because it's this little girl walking the truth into the future. And then from that whole water skirt, coming into places where I'm doing rituals, because I live around so much trauma, and space, the earth holds trauma. So moving rituals of love and intimacy and togetherness in spaces where there have been trauma. This is me at the Ford Foundation in New York. This is me on the campus of UVA. Of course, this is Thomas Jefferson's most sacred place, the lawn. So Thomas Jefferson worked very hard to hide enslaved people. UVA is a beautiful campus. It's beautiful earth. But Thomas Jefferson would not at some point allow students from UVA to bring their slaves with them to school. But you could rent them from the campus. And they were hidden behind these walls, behind very high walls. So I took a ritual walk up the most sacred place into the most sacred place, which is the rotunda at UVA, down from the statue of Thomas Jefferson, where the white supremacists and neo-Nazis circled around on 2 years ago, August 10th and August 11th, and those people who were in that mob around Thomas Jefferson's statue wore the sort of uniform of students from UVA on purpose. They wore khakis and the blue Oxfords, so you couldn't tell who were students and who were members of these white supremacist group. And those people beat students. I don't know if you know that, but there were groups of students, black students, Asian students, white students, who were standing around the statue, and they were beaten by this mob. So doing a circle, a ritual spectacle of beauty and love into the alleyway behind my house in Homewood, the killing fields, working to heal the land and to heal the earth, this is what it takes. That's the art house, kids on the front porch, me feeding kids, because kids get hungry. Moving from my front porch to the first art house, I make signs that say, stop shooting, we love you. Signs that say, love, you are so beautiful. This is the new art house space. And whenever the front door is open at the art house, anybody can come in. There's always food, there's always music, and there's so many art supplies. My neighbors were like, Miss Vanessa, please don't paint that house that neon blue color. Like the old people across the street, they were like, it's too bright. They're like, we want the butter yellow color. And of course, it's blue. Everybody at the bus stop would work on the mosaic. The entire front of the house is covered with mosaic. People come to the art house to this day, and they're like, Miss Vanessa, show my grandchildren the E that I made. They're so proud of it. That's what the side of the house looks like right now. We always dance at the end of the art house. We have kids sometimes ask me, they're like, Miss Vanessa, why are you singing and dancing all the time? You look funny. And I was like, I know I'm singing and dancing all the time. You're not telling me anything. And I had to ask this little boy one day, I said, oh, do you not see happy adults? Is that what's different for you? And he was like, oh, it's not that you're weird, you're happy. So we dance. We dance, and it's important because it's hard. That's a man dead outside of the other art house. So this is very important. It's very important to make time and space for joy. That's Zoe. It's kids in the porch. I made Stop Shooting, We Love You signs, and kids were like, I want to make my own sign. Miss Vanessa, you said I can do what I want to do. I want to make my own sign. So this is after the Pulse nightclub massacre. Grief, needing a space to be whole. This is the field next to the art house. This is like 150 people. I just said on Facebook, we're gonna gather. I'm gonna turn the lights on the house because I don't always turn the love sign on. I said, I'm gonna turn it on. And one by one and more, people start getting off the bus. They just start filling the field. And we had the names of everybody who was killed at that nightclub. And people are holding the names in their hand. And people are helping each other. And they're holding each other's hands. And they're hugging each other. And they're weeping. And all like the little queer trans kids brought their grandmothers with them. And their grandmothers are weeping. And we're standing in the field. And we're all holding each other. And it was amazing. And I thought, where else would we have done this? Where else would we have been able to be together? And I love this photograph because I realize that sometimes we need help. We need guidance just to feel. This is one of the mothers of one of the children who have been killed in Homewood. And as an artist, people know the art house and they know that they can come to me and they can say, Miss Vanessa, we need this thing. And so I've worked with the Pittsburgh Glass Center a lot, and we hand blue tears, these blue tears for all of these women. And Miss Carol, she was just so moved. She was like, I can't believe you just do this. And I'm like, this is what we have. We have each other. We will do for each other. We can do this. This is the art house after I won the Tyson Prize. When I won the week I won the Tyson Prize, I got a summons to go to court. Somebody had called the building inspector on me about the sidewalk, about the roof, about the concrete steps at one of the other houses. And so I was like, why did you have to call on me? You could have just come to me. You could have talked to me. But one of the things that I'm challenged with in Homewood is people always say they. Who did they give you money to do this? Did they say you could do this? Who are they who said that you could do this? And why did they let you do it and not somebody else? And I said, I did what I wanted to do. I won this prize, but I didn't ask for it. I got surprised one afternoon. Rod called me. He's like, Vanessa. He's like, there's this prize. I'm like, that's great, Rod. That's so exciting. And then he's telling me about this prize, and I think he's going to ask me to come to Crystal Bridges and read a poem. And so on the phone with Rod, I'm like, what poem will I read for this person who has won this prize? Will he commission? Is he going to pay me to read the poem? And then he gets to the end of the conversation. He says, you have won this prize. And I'm thinking, that's great, Rod. They're going to give me a pretty plaque. I'm going to need to find a place for this plaque. And then at the very end of the conversation, he said, it comes with a monetary prize. And I was like, well, that's good, Rod. I can do things with money. And he said, it's $200,000. And I almost fell on the floor. I got lightheaded because I was like, oh, my God. I'm gonna not have to go to court all next year. That's what I thought. I was like, oh, they thought they were gonna hem me up, but I'm free, I'm free, I'm free. So we fixing the sidewalk, y'all, you see that? Sidewalk fixed. What we did, because I was like, I know with fresh concrete, you can put things in it. So knowing that there's this desire, there's a desire that people have in the neighborhood for their people to be remembered. So I get on the internet, I'm like, yo, Yo, you got 3 days to let me know if you want to make a butterfly in honor of your person who was lost in Homewood or was connected to Homewood and they're gone. Somebody wrote me, make a butterfly for Derek Taylor. He was a star. He got killed. He was 21. He was on home from break from Slippery Rock University. Make a star for Michael. Make a butterfly for him. And so we put butterflies in the sidewalk. And that whole thing of ritual and pilgrimage and spaces of social healing and the act of love and what it takes to be alive here through the unbearable, it begins in front of the art house. You can follow this field of butterflies from the front of the art house into the alleyway where the killing fields were. Only now we're putting butterflies in the ground. You follow these butterflies and you follow them through the alleyway up the street to the first place where Love Front Porch was, the first art house. This is the end. This is me with my body at Standing Rock. This is Facebook Hill at Standing Rock, because I had to decide that was me protesting in the street, leaving my studio, making art. And I had to decide, you know what, I'm not gonna do this anymore unless doing it is the thing itself. Standing Rock was the thing itself. This is my friend Moreno, got bit by a dog. He's the person in the video with Amy Goodman. When Amy Goodman is yelling, stop, get that dog off of her, she's a pregnant woman. It's Moreno who reaches forward and pulls the dog off that pregnant woman. Amy Goodman got hemmed up for that, right? They charged her with all sorts of rioting and stuff. And then they had to drop those charges because they made that up. I watched that happen. This is me at Standing Rock, because I take art supplies everywhere I go because it's how I survive. This is me painting by Coleman Lantern at the camp. This is kids from the camp around me saying, what are you doing? And I was like, will this happen everywhere I go? So I give all the kids my art supplies. We paint together. This is me leaving camp, and I have just given all the art supplies to these kids, especially this little girl who painted over and over again all this green on pieces of paper, and she would show them to me like they weren't all just green pieces of paper. And I was like, that one is amazing. And she's like, this is the part of the field over there. And I said, it is. I can see that you have talent. And then always, y'all work with kids and paint, they always get it in their mouth. And I would paint these t-shirts, like we would go out to do actions. And people would watch me painting the t-shirts, and I would just end up taking them off and giving them. This is like the second time at camp. You see it's a lot bigger. Just taking a last moment. This is my family. That's my family. And it takes a lot to love in this world. It takes a lot to be whole. It takes a lot to move. So I give gratitude to my people. And this is a quote that I carry with me in all of the love and all the work I do. It's this idea that the next great revolutionary leader is not going to be a single person, but it will be an entire community of people. And I believe that. And I'm looking for other human beings who believe that the future belongs to us. Those of us who can embrace the power of our earthlingness, the power of the fact that we're all here together. Angela Davis asks, what will it take for us to create communities where every human being is valued? And spaces like this, they help us to make communities where every human being is valued. So I took a long time. I love you. I thank you. Thank you for coming up and sharing time with me, and thank you all the kids from Bentonville High School. Thanks. Thanks. We'll take a, you know, it's been a long time. Oh, what's that? Is that Lizzo? It is. So, yo, if you have to go, you have to go. But does anybody have a question? Because that's my right to, like, you can ask a question. Anybody, go to the bathroom. Do what you got to do.
We've got mics on the
yeah,
side.
Yeah, so too. If you're going to stay, take a moment to sit down. If you have to go, I'll see you later. Get home safe. Think about sharing what you love intentionally on purpose once a month. So anybody have a question? Let's take a question. Alice, do you have a question?
I got a question.
All right, you can ask whatever you want.
Miss Vanessa, what are you going to do when you grow up?
When I grow up? Oh, here, I know what I'm going to do when I grow up. I'm going to be safe everywhere I go. I'm not ever going to have to worry about walking into museums and showing my premium membership and people asking me for my ID. I'm going to be safe and happy, and I'm not going to feel like I need to medicate on sugar. And I'm going to get married, and I'm going to invite you, and I'm going to be known as the girl who does graffiti butterflies all over the world, and it won't be really considered graffiti. Oh, I'm dreaming big, Alice, but safety and love and responsible loving, that's what I see for me. Does
Vanessa,
anybody else have a
we want to dream with you.
Does anyone else have a question before we go? All right, y'all, thanks.